I don't know what your family traditions, if you could get together with family this past New Year's Eve. We sometimes have been in New Hampshire with Lois's family. We were up there for Friday and Saturday. We weren't up there for New Year's Eve. So we just had a few of us together, and Lois and I went to bed normal time. It wasn't a big deal, but it was kind of funny. At 5 minutes off, we woke up because one of the neighbors was doing fireworks. So I went, okay, we get to see you in the new year anyway. So we get up. You couldn't see them. They were just under the trees. These homegrown fireworks, I've never bought any. I guess they're fun. But, you know, when you're used to the ones that go 300 feet up in the air, these little guys just, they make noise. Whatever. So I don't know if your new year started with or without fireworks. But what a year 2020 was, or wasn't, depending on your point of view, but out with the old and in with the new, amen? Everybody's ready for something new. How about New Year's resolutions? Anybody make New Year's resolutions? I'll answer the question. Nah, I'm not making New Year's resolutions. Not going to happen. But I think it is time for something or anything better, is it not? You ready for something better than last year? I am, and it wasn't for me personally. It wasn't a bad year. Thank God I had health, good health. My family had good health. We were able to do some things. But it was very frustrating for me as a pastor to try navigate the many various and changing rules for churches. And as was tested in the state of New York, you can't make to the Supreme Court, you're not supposed to make special rules for a church that you don't make for some other group. We'll see how that plays out in the weeks and months to come. But it's been the weirdest year for many of us that we could ever remember or think of. And yet, God is faithful. It is time for something newer, better, whatever, however you want to word that. All of us are looking forward to something. And we look forward to the day when we don't have masks, when everybody can come in. And like most churches, sit in the same old seat you used to sit in anyway. we don't go to different seats. But that's universal. When I went to college, when I went to EMS school, after the first week, once everybody found their seat, where did they go the next day? Same seat. Strange creatures, these humans. How many of you like to build things? Some of you like to build things. I love watching my grandkids build with Legos. They do it on their phones and devices now with Minecraft. They're building all these crazy things. I was shown by one of my kids what some adults have done with Minecraft. They've built, if you don't know what Minecraft is, go home and look it up. I'm not going to explain it all here. But it's a building game on the computer, but you build with blocks. You going to answer my question, Leland? Of course you've got Minecraft. The universe runs on Minecraft. But anyway, one guy built a fully operational PC computer in Minecraft, and you could see all the details and the chips and the board and the whole thing. And they're building all these cities and Taj Mahal. That's not where I'm going to go. I think it's fun to do little projects. If I can accomplish a small project, I feel tremendously empowered and successful. For those of you that built your own home or built things, I remember talking with some friends in years back about some of the projects they were builders that they built over their lifetime. And it's pretty neat. Some of them are pretty amazing things. We're in a building that's 120 years old that actually was well built. That's why it hasn't blown off the hill yet. But it's withstood the storms, and we're still trying to keep the water out of it and those kind of things. So build things. The more time, theoretically, the more time and effort you money you put into something, what should be the result? Theoretically, a better project, the outcome should reflect something about what you have invested into it. And you see that from time to time. We got a Christmas gift from somebody that was homemade, and it was obvious very quickly that the person, one, knew what they were doing. And I don't know how much time and effort they put into it, but the product itself was absolutely beautiful. And I think that's really cool when people can do that. And then, as I mentioned, this building or other things, how long did it last? I've never traveled through to or through Europe. I would like to, if the Lord so wills it. I have been to Israel, though, that has a lot of ancient sites. And the ones that last are made out of usually what? Stone. Stone. Even bricks deteriorate, but something about rocks, they're really slow to disintegrate. But I've been told that for those that visit Europe and travel around, it's just amazing. You know, in America, if you have something 200 years old, you get something old. In Europe, that's still on the young stage. And of course, when you go to the Middle East, it's they get a lot older than that. So when you're going to make something that lasts, it takes something. We like quality, durability, something really solid and lasting. Working in the automobile and truck industry, it was interesting the things that I saw that I believe were, by intention, by design, not built to last. They were built to fail. They were built to rust. And didn't have to be that way. It doesn't have to be that way. But whoever the engineers or whoever the, I don't think it's the engineering so much as the decision makers and penny pinchers, but they don't care if it doesn't last. I care. I like stuff that is quality, built to last, and you do too. We need something strong and durable. And this last week, as I was thinking about the new year, thinking about my own soul and the journey through this past year, and how I hear from person after person, for lack of a better word, they're weary. We're weary of COVID talk. We're weary of COVID precautions. We're weary of how the news media handles it. We're weary of how public health and politicians have handled it. We're tired of it. And it's draining. It's emotionally draining, even though, as I said, in my little world that I live in, I'm relatively healthy and happy. But something that's solid, something you can depend on, something that you know is true, something that you know is reliable, those are the things our souls long for. And David in the Bible understood that. David understood it from a unique perspective. It's true, David didn't live through COVID, but he lived through something else interesting. This is from the scriptures, the introduction to Psalm 18. And in the Hebrew, we find it literally expressed this way. For the director of music of David, the servant of the Lord, he sang to the Lord the words of the song when the Lord delivered him from the hand of all his enemies and from the hand of Saul. And he said, I'm going to keep reading in a moment, but I want you to just process or digest his introduction. He sang to the Lord this song when he'd been delivered from people that wanted to do what? Kill him. He was a fugitive. He was hunted. He, for a time, had to leave his country and took up residency with the Philistines because it was safer living with the enemy than with his own people. Not a good place to be. And then when you read David's story as it goes on in time, after he's become king, years later, one of his own kids wants to kill him. It wasn't an easy life. Yeah, he didn't deal with COVID, but he dealt with stress, fear, anxiety at a level that I've never experienced, and God forbid, I hope I never experience. I do not want to be a hunted person, I'll tell you right now. I've had dreams about that where someone is pursuing me, and you wake up from that pretty worn out, but this was the real deal. But notice the opening words are what? I love you, Lord. Next two words, my strength. This is what caught my attention as I was reflecting about David. He continues on. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge. My shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord who is worthy of praise, and I have been saved from my enemies. The cords of death entangled me. The torrents of destruction overwhelmed me. The cords of the grave coiled around me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to God for help. From his temple, he heard my voice. My cry came before him into his ears. This is just one of many places where David writes similarly. In practice this morning, Steve pulls up a devotion he's just read that meant a lot to him, and it was from Psalm, 62? And it's again, the same theme. The Lord is my rock, my fortress. I will not be moved. So David, I think of David, how he describes God. He's looking for words that express what he has found in his relationship with God. So I just went through what we've read and picked out these words. God, Yahweh, is David's strength. Strength. I mentioned the word weary, fatigue. If you go into a hospital for any reason, they've got to ask you all the COVID symptom questions. And I think it's funny, I went to visit someone in the hospital the other day, and you can tell the gal greeting me is tired of doing it. But she goes, "You have any of these symptoms?" I went, "Yeah, fatigue. I'm 67 and I'm tired. Mark that one down." And she kind of snaps out of it. "What?" I think I'm kidding, partially. But, "Oh, do you have any of these?" And then she talks to the other coworker, and then she reads them all again from memory. I went, "Wow, I wonder what's changed in 3 minutes." "Yeah, something's just changed." Anyway, everybody's tired of it. They're weary. But fatigue sets in. We need strength. And it's not just, I mean, hey, if your resolution is to walk, run, go to the gym, join the Y, go for it. Eat healthier, whatever. But remember, the more bran muffins you eat, it keeps you from getting into heaven. Just remember that one. So we do want to go to heaven. The Lord is my strength. The Lord is my rock. Rock, a place where we've gone hiking a couple times on Mount Desert Island, where in this little parking lot, there's this massive boulder. Almost looks like the bow of a ship. I should have put it up there, the picture. And it's a big rock. I've got a couple rocks in my front yard, and when Jack Tupper was alive, one of them is an outcropping. He said, "You know, for years, Ron, I've wanted to come over here with a backhoe and see how big that rock is." And he said, "I'd like to see if I can dig that out of there." And I thought, do I want him to do that? I don't know. I either have a big hole. He was fascinated by some of the big rocks they found in the pit. Some of them are huge. Out here in the gravel beneath us are some big boulders. When they were drilling one of the wells out here, the guy pinched his drill bit. And he'd been drilling his whole lifetime. He was an older well driller. And he said, "I've never lost a bit to the ground yet, but this one's going to stay there." He says, "I'm going to call my friend's truck in. He's got a bigger truck. Maybe he can twist it out." He says, "I don't like leaving one of those bits there because they're X amount of dollars." He said, "I think it's jammed between two massive boulders. That's what caught it." And he brought his friend came up with his truck, which was a newer, bigger truck. Couldn't move that bit. That whole truck and its tower, he would rock that thing in its side. I wish I had a video of it. Big rocks. They're big things. Yes, we have equipment that can break them up and destroy them. We can drill them and blast them. But a rock is a symbol of strength, durability. You stand on a rock, you know Jesus' story, you build your house in the sand, those storms come, you're a loser. You build it on something solid, it's going to withstand the storm. David liked the word fortress. Now, he didn't actually see some great strong fortresses, but some of his fortresses literally were within the rock. I've been to the Spring of En-Gedi down by the Dead Sea where he and his men had hid from Saul, and there was a lot of caves in the rock there, and the best sort part of it was there was a spring of beautiful clean water, so they had water to drink, good place to hide out. But his fortress, in a sense, was natural rock. That was his picture. He knew God was his deliverer. He was not able to deliver himself. He needed someone far stronger. He knew he needed God for protection as his shield. Why am I wearing this silly thing? It's a shield. It is supposedly protecting you from me and me from you. And time will tell how that really works, right? He said God was the horn of his salvation. Again, a more of a cultural illustration for David in his time. But it was his strength, his security, and that's why he closes in this passage anyway with the stronghold. Those seven descriptors of God based on David's relationship and experience with his God. Well, where do we find strength? Because we all do. We look for it somewhere. We find strength. Some people literally find their strength in their job or their career. Excuse me, they're energized by it. They love what they do. They're successful. believe it or not, I like what I do a lot of the time. I really do. I don't wake up dreading the day or dreading, but I've known people that wake up in the morning and they dread going to work. They dread, that's not their, job is not their, strength. They're not finding that in it. But some people do. I think a lot of us find a lot of strength in our family, and I think that is actually healthy in the way God designed it to be. Some people think they have strength through their savings and investments. Read some world history, people. Paper money is not worth a whole lot if and as it changes, culture and history changes. And even if you have gold, as someone said to me years ago, can't eat gold. If you've got land and seed, you can do something for a while, but we are in Maine. It's really hard growing things. All these things, home and property, they can help us. But if we're finding our strength in these things, this is so transient. It's so short-lived. Good health you could add to the list. And I put down, all these things are good in their place, and many of them can be gifts from a gracious Father God. But to find lasting strength in them, what happens? We will be disappointed. You will be disappointed. And people, when they've been disappointed, you've seen this. Hopefully you haven't experienced it, but you're disappointed enough, you become bitter. You become frustrated. You become angry. That really doesn't bring about good things. Let me go back to David again. So guess where I end up in David with David again, Steve? Psalm 62. For the choir director, according to Jeduthun, a psalm of David, my soul waits in silence for my God, for God only. From him is my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold. I shall not be greatly shaken. My soul wait in silence for God only, for my hope is in him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my stronghold. I shall not be shaken. It's repeated again. O God, my salvation and my glory, rest. The rock of my strength, my refuge is in God. Trust in him at all times. Pour out your heart before him. I don't know why the other one showed up first. That's my editing. Don't blame any of the tech people. This is my editing. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us, Selah. Now, the first one that's supposed to show up is be willing to wait in silence. Be willing to wait in silence. Is it hard for me to wait in silence? You bet. I like silence when I sleep, but most of the time I like to be doing stuff, going, and yes, I talk a lot. So silence is a discipline. To wait on the Lord in silence is a discipline, and disciples should practice disciplines. To wait for him in silence. To remind myself of the fact, the truth, where God is my strength, I will not be greatly shaken because I have a fortress. A lot of stuff going on that we don't like in the world around us, but I am not going to be greatly shaken. If I am being greatly shaken, then I should reassess, what am I looking for strength? Where am I going for solutions? If I'm not going to God, it's no wonder I'm frustrated. And then the call, call to pray. One of these is backwards. Pour out your heart before him, pray. To pour out your heart before him. I've seen this, I haven't experienced it much, but I have seen this with other people. Sometimes life gets to the place where their hearts are broken. And a broken heart sometimes can more easily pour out its contents. And I don't know why God has to take us down that road, but sometimes he does. And in that place of brokenness, you might say the real us, the real me, the real you comes out before God. And guess what? That's what he's been looking for the whole time, the real person. He doesn't want us to fake or pretend the whole thing. Pour out your heart before him. Well, it is 2021, but we still live with political unrest. We still live with COVID uncertainties. We still live with all of life's other challenges. Can we really find what we need in God? Now, I'm talking about to those of you that have put your faith in God. If you haven't come there yet and you don't know, I'll get to you in a minute. But for now, if you and I have, say, and rightly so, I have put my faith in Christ, then what should that look like? How should that be? How, if I may, how tangible should that be, my relationship with my God? If David could, before Messiah came, before Christ came to earth, and it's supposed to be then, not they, then we of all people should, because Messiah has come, we should find our strength and remember this. David was looking for Messiah's first coming. We, I think, friends, are not far from his second coming. Not far. I haven't got a spiritual GPS to tell me how far away it is, but, you know, on the GPS in the car, it'll say you've mapped in your trip. It'll say, you know, your arrival time is travel time, 1 hour, 19 minutes, whatever, and it keeps readjusting that depending on traffic and all that stuff. I don't know when the Lord's coming, but most of us, in looking around us, see a lot of things coming into place that look like what Scripture has talked about, been in Scripture for over 2,000 years, are about to happen around us. So, Jesus coming, second time, for his own, to judge the world. This is how Peter would write about it. And I like Peter's letters because Peter's such a real person. Peter is not a fake. I don't think there were many people that ended up being fakes in Scripture. That's the beauty of Scripture. Their sins show up, their failures, their weaknesses, but then the grace of God shows up with that as well, and we need to see that. Yeah, we're sinners in need of grace. That's why Jesus came. So Peter, as you know, had messed up. He wasn't with the program the whole time by a long shot. But he writes this, so I take it from a guy like me who's stumbled around enough to say, wait a minute, this is what I need to know. Above all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, where is this coming he promised? Ever since our ancestors died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation. Peter continues, though, but they deliberately forget that long ago, by God's word, the heavens came into being, and the earth was formed out of water and by water. By these waters also the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for what? Fire. This is serious stuff. Being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire, and the earth and everything done in it will be laid bare. Then his concluding comment, verse 11. Since everything will be destroyed in this way, very logical question here. What kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives as you do something. And this is key to this passage. It's the key, I think, to our getting through another crazy year. As you look forward to the day of God and speed it's coming. Looking forward. I like looking forward to stuff. I told Lois sometime last week, I said, hey, we don't have any vacations on the map. We got to plan something. I want something to look forward to. And anybody else like that? You got to have something to look forward to. It's good. And I'm old enough, I don't look forward to birthdays and stuff like that. You got to look forward to a vacation, something really good. You plan something. So we look forward to the Lord's return. Even though Peter's just said everything's going to be toast, what is not toasted is eternal. Oh. That's because God's in me, his spirit, because of Jesus' work. And I thought of these words from Jesus in John's gospel. Because when Jesus is our rock, this is the result. But the advocate, Jesus was saying at the time of the Last Supper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I've said. And then here's his promise, and I put it in boldface there so it'd show up better. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. Therefore, do not let your hearts be troubled, and don't be afraid. Peace. God's peace. I go on Facebook because I have family and friends that communicate with me through Facebook. Whatever. But I see a lot of unpeace on Facebook. I watch the news because I want to know if we have a snowstorm coming and, you know, if part of the country has fallen into the ocean, I kind of want to know that or whatever. I try to follow the news because I think it's a necessary part of my existence as a pastor is keeping track. I don't follow all the sports closely, never did. It's even worse now because I'll turn it on and say, they're playing before an empty stadium. There's something wrong with this picture. That is weird. Anyway, so Jesus gives us peace. I do not have to. I can choose to, but I do not have to let my heart be afraid. He said, you don't have to. It really is a choice. My focus, my thoughts, what I fill my mind with, all impact where I'm going to go with this. Now, I'm going to do just a sidestep here for a moment for my, this is my next to last slide, but we're going to have communion today. If you're a church member, 12:30, I'll do it from home again. It'll be on Facebook Live. But I'm longing for the time when we can sit together and do it again as a church family here, all together, everybody. And really make that, because the whole point of communion is connectedness. To commune is to communicate. It's a connection. And to do it on Facebook, and I see people posting on that, but when I've done it the last, whatever it's been, 8 months, I'm like, this is not how it's supposed to work. And I know some of you will say, well, make it happen, and we're working on it. We'll see how we can make it happen here. But there is the place where, as disciples, as followers of Jesus Christ, we need to make sure we are staying connected. And it's connection is a two-way thing. It's not a one-way thing. You may say, well, Pastor, you haven't called me in weeks, and you should have. You're right. I probably should have. But last I knew, you still have the ability to call me, too. I mean, it's a two-way thing. Communication kind of works that way. Somebody says, you haven't talked to me in a long time. That's just kind of a weird opener. Start talking and I'll talk back, maybe, most likely. Don't tell me I haven't talked with you. Anyway, you've got it. So communion, to communicate, to relate, to interact. And maybe you're thinking, well, I'm not sure I am a disciple of Jesus. What does that mean? Good question. Glad you asked. The Bible tells us it's not a formula, but it's like anything else. To move forward, you take steps, right? You're going to move forward, you take steps. Pauline has had to have work on her foot, so she takes a step and rolls. But anyway, it's moving forward, forward progress. Early on in my training as an EMT, our head paramedic for our department said, everything should be forward progress. Don't stall and stay on something too long. The goal is to get the patient to the hospital in a timely and correct manner. Move forward. So how do we move forward? Take steps. One. Tell Jesus you're sorry for your sins. If you're not sorry for your sins, there's a problem right there. Because sins do two things. They hurt people horizontally. My sins hurt people I know. This is just how it works. I'm not making this up. The other thing it does is it breaks my relationship between a holy God that loves me and wants me to spend eternity with him and wants to commune with me here and now. So we need to tell God the honest truth. I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior, and I'm sorry for my sins. It's not good stuff. And then the Bible tells us to actually call on the person of Jesus for salvation, not just in a generic sense, but in a very specific sense, because only Jesus could pay the penalty for my sin. Nobody else could. Because Jesus was fully man, fully God. He lived a perfect life. He took on himself the sins of the world on that cross. That load of sin was so great that for the first time in all eternity, his Father had to look away because Ron Parker's sins were on the Christ on the cross. So I call on Jesus, the only one who could and did purchase salvation for me. And when I do that, there's a transaction that takes place. Jesus comes into my life through his Spirit. and he becomes my Lord. I have to grant him that. He doesn't bulldoze his way in. He wants to be your Lord because he knows that's the best place you can be. But you got to grant him that. Receive him, like receiving a gift as your Lord. And when that simple process happens, you and I are on our way to heaven. We're headed there. We're on our way there. I am on my way to heaven as I speak. I don't think that means a heart attack in 5 minutes, but it might be. I don't know. God only knows that stuff. But I know I'm on my way to heaven. My destiny is secure because of my Savior. So we take 2021, and here we go, I think, off to a good start. And especially when David would write again, this was a psalm I was more familiar with, Psalm 46, for the choir director, a psalm of the sons of Korah. David, I'm sure, worked with them on this because it's all his language they've heard him say. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. It's as though the earth do change and there's these cataclysmic events that happen. Things fall into the sea, roaring of the waves. I won't fear because God is my refuge and strength. When fear and anxiety come and try to pull you down, and it has, and it will, remember who your God is. And I say that to myself. I'm not preaching at you. This is from my heart as much as anybody's. Remember who your God is. Remember who your Savior is and the price he paid to bring you home. And lastly, remember who you are in Christ. Your identity is in Christ. My identity is in Christ. Whatever's going on in this crazy world around us, no matter what rules they make for church or against the church, it doesn't change who I am in Christ. They can't change that. They can't take that from me. They can't take that from you. Hang on to that. God will get us through. It's his promise. It's his word. As I said to someone, I've said it actually many times in recent weeks, you know, with all the swirl of stuff going on, I know this really, who's speaking the truth? Which news media is speaking the truth? I don't know. I try to sort it out just like you do. But I do know every time I open my Bible or I go to it electronically and I remember a scripture, my Bible is tested truth. And that's what counts, tested truth. So that's what I need. I believe that's what the world needs. You need too. But as I look back, never once did God leave us alone. He was faithful. He walked with me through last year. He walked with you. He'll walk with us. Lord, we're declaring that because we believe it. It doesn't change you because you already are and always have been the faithful one. But it sure helps my soul. It sure helps us when we refocus, when we get a clearer picture of your greatness, your strength, how solid, on Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. The old hymn picking up off the Gospels is right on. You are my fortress, my shield, my deliverer, my Savior. Lord, this is what my heart needs. This is what our hearts need. You are faithful. Never once did we walk alone. Or, looking ahead to this new year, will we walk alone? You are with us. And as Paul would write in Romans, if God is for us, who can be against us? We've got it. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. So, Lord, for those of us who know you and love you and worship you, we receive that strength and life from you in your word. Thank you, faithful Spirit, for your ability to renew us and strengthen our hope and the resolve to live lives, as Peter says, in this ungodly stuff all around us. No, we're called to live more closely to you, to be the light and salt you've asked us to be. And in a world that's really rotten and really in darkness, we're to be light and salt because of you, Jesus, who you are. And maybe there's someone watching or someone here, they're not clear on this and like, wow, what do I do? I need some stability in my life. Come to Jesus right now, just simply, honestly, humbly. Jesus, I'm a sinner. I believe you can be and will be my Savior. I invite you into my heart as my new Lord, as my new boss. Thank you for dying on the cross for my sin. If you pray that prayer, let me know. Let someone you know and love know so we can guide you in that walk as you start out. And Lord, we go from this place grateful that you'll never leave us or forsake us. We have your Spirit. We have literally everything we need for life and godliness because you have provided it. Thank you for this new year. Thank you for my church family, both those that are here and those on Facebook. We're looking forward to the day when we party here together and we party in your presence. Amen. We praise you, Lord. We're going to go in your grace. We'll be off the air. Thank you if you were watching. If you are a follower of Christ, we'll have our monthly Facebook communion service at 12:30. I'm down to doing about my Facebook blogs about two a week now. Hopefully do one tomorrow. God bless you. Thank you for joining us.